New Jersey Bow, wow.
I do remember my first day in the public relations department.
Well, my first day at New Jersey Bell, I think, was the day I was hired.
Yes, I can remember my first day at New Jersey Bell.
My first day in New Jersey Bell, I don't think I'll ever forget. I was right here in the public office on the first floor, which doesn't even exist anymore. And the manager said to me very calmly, "Dwayne, we just want you to know that you're bonded. If anyone holds you up, don't be a dead hero. Give them the money." I was ready to walk out the door.
Before we really get started, though, can I just say one thing? Can we make this real short? It's almost lunchtime, and the cafeteria gets awful crowded.
My first day at New Jersey Bell, well, at the time the war was still on, World War II, not World War I. World War II was still on, and telephone company needed part-time helpers, so while attending high school, I was able to get a job at New Jersey Bell on Saturday, and of course the high point of my career at that time was payday.
I started, of course, in school, in a training class that they used to run for newly hired salesmen. The first day we were there, Pete told me I had to go out, all of us had to go out and buy a fedora. And because a salesman for the telephone company had to wear a fedora. And that shocked me. I'd never worn a hat in my life. And I can remember we went to a hat store in Patterson, and I sat down in the chair, and the salesman brought all these hats out. And he had a mirror in front of me, and I was trying the hats on, and it was ridiculous. But I'll never forget, I looked in the mirror, and my mother and father were sitting behind me going like this. Frank Dwyer, the fellow that I was replacing, spent this day going through the desk showing me where everything was. And he kept referring to something called copy paper. And each time he would say, "Now, when you do this every month, all you do is do it on copy paper and hand it in. Or you just keep your notes on copy paper." And I was a little bit puzzled by this. Finally, we got down to the lowest drawer in the right-hand side of the desk, and he opened it up and he said, "Now there's your copy paper." And I said, "Wait a minute, Frank, you've referred to copy paper all along. What does that mean? Do you have to keep a copy of everything you do?" He said, "No, you just use copy paper." I said, "Well, what is copy paper?" And I guess it was then that I realized I had an awful lot to learn about public relations.
I had come down to Newark to find some clothing. I had been in the Army for 4 years, and I still had my Army uniform, and I had no civilian clothes, and I knew if I wanted to apply for a job, I better be dressed properly. So I came down to Newark and went to Bonds and ordered a suit, because they gave two pair of pants at that time. Finally, I got up to Military Park, to Washington Park, across the street here. And just as I stood there, I realized there was no more stores to go to, but a telephone truck went in front of me around the statue. And I saw that it was in good shape and had been well maintained. And in the Army, I had done a number of motor pool inspections, and it just hit me, that must be a good outfit.
I was hired to be a service rep and reported to my respective business office, which was the wrong location. I should have gone to this building here at 540 to attend service rep class, so I ended up in the wrong spot.
I finally got permission from my supervisor and was observed to call the customer. By this time, the tolls were in the area of $3,000 to $4,000. So we called the customer, and I told her that we had these returns or calls going to her residence, and that these calls amounted to about that sum of money. She panicked, thinking I was going to charge her for the calls, and proceeded to rattle off all kinds of information. At that point, I called the base. They had the provost marshal get involved. And approximately 2 or 3 weeks later, I got a phone call from the provost marshal at Fort Dix thanking me for his assistance. And I said, "For what? What did I do?" He said, "You helped us break up a pro house in New York." And he did, too. They staked it out.
When a guy by the name of Bill Jameson left here, when we were doing a party for him, we decided to go out and rent that gorilla suit again. It was a real authentic-looking gorilla suit. So I decided to take the gorilla suit home. And in those days, I was riding with Bill Loper in his little TR3, a little British sports car with the top down. And so after the party was over, I put the gorilla suit on and sat in the car next to Bill, and we were driving home. And we went up MacArthur Highway here out onto Route 21. And you won't believe this, but it is a true story. We're driving down Route 21, and there's red lights flashing up ahead. It's a roadblock. Now, in those days, it wasn't the DWI. They used to stop and check you for license, registration, and whatnot. But even if it wasn't DWI, we had just left the party, and, well, we would have been in a little trouble, I guess. But anyhow, we're approaching the red lights, and Bill said, "Do you see what I see?" And I said, "Yep." And he said, "Jesus, you better get out of that suit." Well, I took the head of the suit off, and it was big, and there was no room to put it. In the little TR3, there's no way I could have put the head of that gorilla. So I said, "This is it. Well, they're going to stop us. We better start thinking up a story." Well, with that, as we approached the roadblock, an officer stopped out and waved us right on, waved us right past, because they had enough people there already. Well, you talk about luck. Another incident happened, though. We stopped at a red light, and we were in the left-hand lane, and I had put the suit back on again, and a car pulled up next to us on a right, and there was a little gentleman sitting in the car, and he looked over at us, and I turned to him in a gorilla suit and went,
Well, giving a talk, we didn't wear the stockings we were wearing in those days, and one day, one little item just disengaged itself, and while I was presenting a slide presentation, the stocking was dropping to the ankle. And how do you bend down? You could bend down and pick up a remote controller, but how do you bend down and pick up the stocking? You just don't.
I got to the meeting room for the Florence Junior Chamber of Commerce at about 4:15. Nobody else was there except the projectionist. Bless his heart, he was there. But I figured he had set up in the wrong room, because he was in a room that wasn't any wider than 12 feet and maybe 15, 18 feet long. Had a big table in the middle of it with a dozen chairs around it. Well, here I was prepared to talk to 400, 500, 600 people. A few minutes after 7, two people came in, and within the next 10 or 15 minutes, another 4 came in. And T-shirts, just plain undershirts, slacks, sneakers. Here I was, dressed like I'd just walked out of a store window. I introduced myself to them. They said, "Well, we have a few business items to get underway, if you don't mind waiting." But I said, "No, it's all right, I'll wait." So I sat in the back corner of the room. And for the next 30 minutes, it went kind of like this. "Now, Charlie, we figured that this year we'll have you do the float for the Memorial Day parade in another month." And Charlie would say, "No f***ing way, man. I did that f***ing float last year, and I ain't doing it this year. Get some other s***head to do it, because I'm not touching the f***ing float." "Well, Charlie, let's be reasonable now. You want to do the float for the Memorial Day parade, or you want to do our booth for Labor Day?" "Why can't you get somebody else? Why is it always me? Charlie, do this f***ing job. Charlie, do that f***ing job. What's wrong with Jules?" At this point, Jules, who had been just sort of sitting happy to let it go between Charlie and the president, said, I know. "Listen, you got me on that float last year. You didn't make me organize it, but you made me stand up on it. And Jesus, it was hot on that goddamn float, and I ain't doing it. So get somebody else. Labor Day is no good either. I ain't doing that one either." Well, they went on like this for a full 30 minutes, and finally, at the end of it, the chairman said, "All right, we ain't settled that, but let's have our program now. We got a guy here from public service with a movie. Go ahead, fella."
Okay, here we go. 1, 2, 3. God bless you.
In the 12 months, 14 months that Jack Simpson's been away, I've gotten 6 letters from him asking for advice on Social Security, how to avoid New Jersey income tax, what is your rollover's IRA. Don't do that to me, please. God. Good luck, all of you. Goodbye. We'll miss you all.
Good.
Bye.
Best
wishes
to
you.
The thing that feels most endearment to me as far as pride goes is working with the kids in the schools. It was really, again, a community service with a reward that came back.
Advertising is exciting. It's changing. It's fun. You can use a little creativity. There aren't too many rules and regulations that you have to follow, and I just loved advertising.
Bernie, from Bozo and Jacobs, we're going to miss your inspired leadership. A couple of your old friends couldn't make it today. They're always late, Mike Manning, Bill Burling. But goodbye, Bernie. We'll see you. Goodbye, Bernie. Goodbye, Bernie. Goodbye, Bernie. We wish you very well. Bye, Bernie.
Bye, Bernie.
Bye, Bernie.
My favorite assignment, I would have to say, was the past few years in public relations, because it made it fulfilled my desires of meeting with the public and also traveling throughout the state.
The best assignment was the last one, the news job. I feel almost uniquely lucky to have had this assignment during a time when the telecommunications industry was always the number one business story, and at times the number one story, period.
My favorite assignment was being advertising manager of AT&T. It was a grand life. Had 3 different agencies that we were dealing with, free lunch every day, all the magazines, all the media wanting your business, and it was really a top point of my life in public relations.
Hope you guys all hang in there, and goodbye, and good luck, and so long, and farewell, and
see you later.
Da, 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 da.
Wow!
Bye-bye, we'll be seeing you.
Oh, goodbye, everybody.
Adios, amigos.
Oh, I will be remembered from cracking the whip and enforcing the laws.
But I've done well, and I've been working at it since 1954, is the payroll. Payroll just doesn't happen. Someone is behind it, making sure that it's correct.
The community relations job, I was in that for about 6 years, and feel that I was pretty instrumental in setting up the whole community relations review process, and which did this company very well, I think, because it really got community relations recognized as a very important part of the job. And I felt good about that.
Being exposed to the staff in our public relations department is another area I would have to say was very rewarding. This you would never encounter in an accounting department. There were other fields there, but nevertheless, not as an illustrious group as our PR people.
Giving people the freedom to do their jobs. And there were probably some people who were for me who felt they were under-supervised because of that. That could be. But I think people develop better in their work if they have that kind of supervisor. And I've been very lucky in that the people who work for me have been able to do that.
What is the thing that I'd like to be remembered for? That's probably better asked of others. It's kind of hard for me to say. I imagine the average person today would probably say divestiture.
Oh, we're going to miss you when you're gone, but I want you to know that you're leaving the public relations department in good hands.
Bye.
Bye.
Happy trails.
Bye, everyone. Ciao.
Good luck. And goodbye.
The people who are leaving, Fred Griffin, Bernie Grubel, Joanne Scowcroft, Nels Runger, Dwayne Grimm, will never be replaced.
I'll never forget Bernie because when I first became a general community relations manager in 71, Bernie was one of the 2 district fellows that reported to me. And after very few days on the job, Bernie came in one morning and said, Nels, would it be okay if I'd leave at 1 o'clock today? Oh, you know, when you're a brand new boss, you don't want to say what the hell for. So I said, sure, well, you got something special? And he said, well, yeah, I said, I want to go home and see Gunga Din on television. I thought, well, you know, that's whatever turned you on. I said, gee, haven't you ever seen these? He says, oh, yeah, I've seen it about 18 times.
Nels, here's one for you. Remember when Jim Brunson sent the six of us down to, I think it was Western Electric in Hopewell? We were known as the Seaview Six. So we went down there and worked very, very diligently on putting together a program. Jim Brunson had put me in charge of the logistics, getting the typewriters down there, arranging for the rooms, the meals, and all that kind of thing. And we got there, and the first evening, I think it was Pete Hoffman or Ed Schwartz or somebody said, what about cocktail time? Don't we have a little cocktail time? Well, I hadn't really thought of that, and so I said, well, no problem. I went back, and I asked Nels Runge. I knew he had a company car, so I said to Nels, can I borrow your car to run down into Princeton? And he said, sure. So he gave me the keys, and I went down into Princeton, and I parked the company car right in front of the liquor store, and there was New Jersey Bell on the side, you know, and the whole thing. And so I go in the liquor store, and I didn't think too much of it, but I'm bringing out two cases of beer and putting them in the trunk, and then I went back in and got some bottles and put those in the trunk and some ice. And there were two elderly women standing out there, kind of, they weren't really paying attention, but they kind of walked by, and I thought to myself, gee, this doesn't look so good, does it? And on the way back, I thought, gee, I'm going to tell Nels something. So when I got back to the place, I brought Nels the keys back, and I said, Nels, I think you're in trouble. And he said, what do you mean? I said, well, you know, I took your company car. And he said, yeah, do you have an accident? I said, no, nothing like that. It's just that when I was in the liquor store bringing the liquor out and putting it in the company car, these two elderly women stopped and said, young man, are you with the telephone company? What are you doing putting all that liquor in the telephone company car? And Nels, this time, is getting a little concerned expression on his face. And although they didn't say anything, I said to Nels, yeah, they were very concerned. In fact, they asked me what my name was. And I said, well, I don't think I have to tell you my name. And so with that, I slammed down the trunk of the car and started to take off. But I noticed they wrote down the license plate number of the car. So if you get a call, Nels, you better, you know, be aware.
I will always remember, Bernie, we had a promotion down in the lobby, and as people came in, baseball theme. Bernie was dressed up as a baseball player, and he had papier-mâché baseballs made up. And as people came in, he stood and threw these baseballs at you. It was to get your attention to know we were in a campaign to sell. Well, as all the officers came in, Bernie threw these baseballs at them. And they didn't think it was as funny as Bernie thought it was.
We love you, Bernie. Oh, yes, we do.
Fred has been on me most of my career to get my hair cut. And, you know, I look at Fred's haircut and I say, well, you know, I don't want to go that drastic. So I decided to keep it long. Fred used to get terribly upset, though, and see me in the men's room with long hair. But he was always happy when I told them I'd go to a barber and get an estimate.
We love you, Bernie, we do. Oh, Bernie, we love you.
Bernie, well, he has always been nice to do business with and for. He especially was happy on payday when I showed up with the paycheck.
One was Nels when he introduced Peter Ventimiglia to the department in a meeting down in Vail Hall. Nels did it by singing an Italian opera using Peter Ventimiglia's name in the opera. That was a little unusual, to say the least.
Go ahead, Brian. Nels, we're going to miss your chicken song.
I thought you'd never ask. We had some chickens, no eggs would they lay. We had some chickens, no eggs would they lay. My wife said, honey, we're losing money. Because those chickens, no eggs will they lay. One day a rooster flew into our yard and caught them chickens right off of their guard. They're laying eggs now, just like they used to, ever since that rooster flew into our yard. Join me. They're laying eggs now, just like they used to, ever since that rooster flew into our yard.
Goodbye, all.
Bye-bye, guys. Happy trails.
Say goodbye.
Goodbye.
Wave. Wave goodbye, bunny.
And hats off to all of you.
I'd like to offer my best wishes and congratulations to each one of you, but I don't want to make this a long, drawn-out affair. So I'll wish you all the very best, and then I will simply pop off.
Am I happy about the changes that I've seen with divestiture? I know what the party line is, but I'd have to say I'm not happy with the changes that I've seen. But that doesn't mean that in the future it's not going to be a good thing. Right now it is difficult. It is very difficult.
I just don't know when it's going to settle down, when the dust is going to settle down, and when we'll be able to get on track and really do what we should be doing, which is providing customers with the service that we do provide.
The basic driver was improving technology that made it possible for more people to play the game. And you can't stop technology. Technology isn't good or bad, it just happens.
I think the breakup of this industry will make the operating company stronger.
I'm not selling my stock. I'll stay with it.
From all of us to all of you, good luck and God bless you.
Goodbye,
everyone.
Goodbye.
Goodbye
and good luck.
Goodbye, y'all. Y'all come back now, you hear?
I know we'll all have some big shoes to fill now that you folks are gone, but for me, that won't be a problem. Lynette doesn't wear any. Bye, folks. Have a great retirement.
Bye.
Best of luck, folks. Have a real good time.
Bye.
Goodbye. Good luck. Farewell. God bless you all.
Goodbye.
I want to say goodbye to all the people who are retiring. I'm going to miss them.
I hope you have great outlooks. Goodbye.
First of all, I'd say you must be honest. They both begin with H. Honesty is absolutely important, especially in public relations, because you can't fool employees and you can't fool the public. So never try to be anything other than honest. And the other thing is, you've got to have humor. We've got to have a little fun when we do the job. And if you mix those two together in the right proportion, I think it will be a happy and profitable time for both the employees and the company.
Okay, go ahead, Helen.
Hey, Marie, what happened to the coffee? Where's the bagels?
It's coming. The dining service a little late.
Oh, but are they fresh today? You know all the time we got the hot pots.
I know those hot rubbers now.
David, how many are you eating this morning?
I'm only going to have three.
Oh, Jesus. What's wrong with you? All right, enough. The meeting of the unknown group will please come to order.
Why?
The first item on our agenda this morning, if you check your papers, has to do with...
We're off.
Check for your papers.
I have one.
Oh, you want to get it? Yeah, right.
One,
oh, here it is. Here's that. I zero on the coffee.
Where are the crayons?
Fred, I just wanted to let you know that I'm ending my career just like I started it, quiet and sedately, 38 years ago when we first met. Goodbye, and I'm not far behind you.
Fred, I just want to wish you all the best, and you've left it in good hands. Good luck.
Fred, I haven't known you long, but good luck with your tennis and anything else you do. Bye.
Fred, I'd like to say goodbye to you. It's been a pleasure working with you over all these years, and I'm sure you'll agree that the group's appearance has improved since we've been with you. Best luck in your retirement.
Mr. Griffin, I just want to say best wishes and good luck on a healthy and happy retirement, and God bless you.
This is the last meeting of the Outcasts of Poker Flats. The group just won't be the same without you, Fred. We're going to miss you. We all wish you well, much happiness, and good health.
What the job calls for as much as anything else is patience. for accepting the fact that no matter how many times you have told a given audience, whether it's employees or shareholders or customers or competitors or what, a given set of facts or information, it'll always bear repetition.
I am going to regret not working with these people again. Pursuing another job outside is out of the question, because I would never meet the same crowd that I've worked with here.
Good luck to all of you. I've enjoyed being with you, and I will always remember you.
I just think I'll forget the bad times, remember the good times, and think about you all.
Goodbye, Dwayne.
I'd like to have people say, oh yeah, I remember old What's-His-Name, he used to write songs. Wherever your long journey ends, don't forget we're your friends. Bye, bye, PR. If you need us, one and all, we'll be at your beck and call. Bye, bye, PR. Even though your days may all be sunny, there may come a time when you need money. Remember, we're all tried and true, but don't call us, we'll call you. PR, bye, bye. Okay.
Hey, gang. This is a good bye. So long. Good luck.
I want to wish you all the luck in the world. Best wishes.
Wish you good luck. Buena suerte para todos and goodbye. Adios. Y cójanlo suave.
Goodbye and good luck. May you spend more years in retirement than you did in employment.
Happy retirement. We'll miss you all. Happy days. Goodbye.
We've only just begun to live. And promises, a kiss for luck, and we're on our way.
We've only begun
before the rising sun. We fly so many roads to choose. We start out walking and learn.
Goodbye, everyone.
Goodbye. Good luck.
Goodbye, everyone. We'll miss you all. And we'll be thinking of you while I'm out in the Bahamas. And Greece in the fall. And who knows, maybe Australia for Christmas. Eat your heart out.
So long, everybody. We'll see you around, and best of luck to all of you. I'm going to miss you.